This is the famous verse from the Bhagavad-Gita 247. It states, karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phala heturbhur ma te sangostva karmani. So karmanyevadhikaraste, Krishna says, the way to work, the art of work is to work without attachment to the results. Now this, in today's psychology, makes no sense at all. Because most self-help books will tell, before you start a work, visualize the result. You know, if you're giving an exam, visualize yourself with the certificate, with the trophy, whatever it is you're going to achieve. And with that vision in mind, work. So in one sense, is the Gita telling the exact opposite? And if we don't visualize the result, if we don't aspire for the result, then why would we work at all? So why would the Gita give such a counterintuitive instruction that work without attachment to the results? Now, this is a very significant teaching and it's simplistic. I was giving a talk in Yale Medical College and there was a Islamic professor of Hindu studies over there. And he said, I read the Bhagavad Gita and this is one thing that never made sense to me. He said, right now you are here because you want all of us to understand what the Bhagavad Gita is. So are you not attached to that result? Are you not attached to wanting us to understand? How can anyone work without attachment to the results? So I told him, that this verse is not as simple as it seems. Why? Because the Gita differentiates between goals and results. It is not against setting goals. It is against being attached to the results. And I'll explain what is the difference. So, usually what happens is, we choose actions, what I should do and what I should not do based on the results. If we feel, okay, this particular area, I'm unlikely to be successful. The efforts are too many. Maybe let me not do this. This, yeah, it's more reasonable. So we do it. And when we do a particular activity also, if we get the results, we become inflated. Yeah, I'm so great. I'm so glorious. I'm so successful. Without results, we become deflated. I'm useless. Many times we may see this duality on a tennis court. When the winning shot is hit, the winner just, yahoo, the winner jumps up in the sky. And the loser just sinks into the ground, drooping as if the whole world has ended for them. Now, of course, not all tennis players are like that. But sometimes we see these extreme dualities. So we, in general, we seem to function quite in a result-centric way. So what's wrong with that? So what the Gita says is something very significant, that, see, the results are not in our control. And when we obsess over the results, there is a problem. So therefore, the Gita says, be more concerned about what the work does inside you than what it does outside you. What does it mean, basically? So as students, we study. Now, obviously, when we study, we want to get good marks. Yes, that's true. However, in the long run, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years down the line, when you are in a career, how many marks you got in which term exam won't make that much of a difference. How much you learn the subject, and more importantly, how much you develop a discipline to study, to train your mind, to develop a mind that is eager to learn, that will make a huge difference. So the work does some change outside and the work does some change inside. So the Gita's focus is, don't get so caught in what change the work is going to do outside. Yes, I could have got the first rank, but I got the second rank or I got the fifth rank. Yeah, that's a difference. In the world's eyes, it's a big difference right now. But in the long run, if you have developed an ethos of diligence, of discipline, of responsibility, that will stand you in a good stead. Einstein also phrased this slightly differently. He said, be not a person of success, be a person of values. Values is what happens inside us. So the Gita, now of course there are multiple levels of what we can talk about values, but the principle is, the Gita is telling us that what is outside is not in our control. Sometimes we may study very, very well, but just some things happen and maybe we don't get as, maybe we fall slightly sick before the exam and we don't get very good marks in the exam because we are not able to perform well. Does that mean all our studies was in vain? No. We did do our part. We learned, we put in the hard work, we mastered the subject, and more importantly, we developed a trained mind to learn. That is invaluable. So sometimes the intangible successes, which are the changes that happen inside us, we may completely forget them when we get obsessed with the tangible changes in the outside world. So in that sense, the Gita's message, be detached from the fruits of the work. It is empowering. How empowering? Because it shifts our attention to what is in our control and not what is beyond our control. The results outside are beyond our control. The results inside are in our control. So the Gita's message in that sense empowers each one of us. So let's look at this from another perspective, that these are the four D's in functioning. In Sanskrit, these are called as karma, daiva, kala. So karma is duty, kala is duration, and daiva is destiny. So these three come together to give us the phala, the desired result. So a simple example could be farming. In farming, the duty is to sow the seeds and plow the land. That's what the farmer does. Then the destiny is rains have to come in the right time, in the right quantity. And then the duration is the farmer cannot get the grains, the harvest immediately. The farmer has to wait till the harvesting season comes. So duration has to pass. And then the results come. So among these four factors, if we consider, the only factor that is in our control is duty. Now we are obsessed about the results and we often think that our actions lead to the results. It's not that simple. Yes, our actions contribute to the results, but they are not the sole cause of the result. So when the Gita says, don't be attached to the results, what it means is, mate karma phala hetur bhur. Don't think that you alone are the cause of the results. So because we alone are not the cause of the results, therefore don't be too worried if the results don't come. Don't be obsessed with the results. Don't be elated if the results come. Don't be dejected if the results don't come. Do your duty. And eventually, we will get good results. When the duration passes, when the destiny becomes favorable, the results will come. So we need patience. And so the detachment which the Bhagavad-Gita talks about is more about acceptance, that after I have done what is in my control, let me not obsess over that which is not in my control. And I started this point by saying that there's a difference between goals and results. Setting goals is perfectly fine. In fact, after the Bhagavad-Gita was spoken, the Kurukshetra war was fought. And Krishna and Arjuna were together. Krishna was the charioteer of Arjuna. And every day during the Kurukshetra war, Arjuna set goals. Okay, this is the regiment of the opposite army that I am going to deal with today. These are the opposing warriors that I am going to neutralize today. Most famously, on the 14th day, Arjuna said, I will bring down Jayadrath, who was responsible for his devious role in the vicious killing of my son, Abhimanyu. And when Arjuna set that goal, by sunset today, either Jayadrath will die or I will die. Krishna didn't tell him, hey Arjuna, you forgot karma nevadhikaraste. No, because that's not the implication of karma nevadhikaraste. See, for us to do our duty wholeheartedly, visualizing the goals can motivate us. And that's wonderful. So the Gita is not against visualization of the goals. Yes, we visualize the goals. However, after we have done our duty, then let go. Then understand that this doing the duty was my control, and doing the duty was my part in getting the results. But beyond that, I don't have a part. So if the results may come, they may not come. So by this bigger picture, we can develop greater steadiness. Sometimes when results come, sometimes when results don't come. When results come, we won't become proud and arrogant, thinking just, see, I am so great. And when results don't come, we won't become depressed and deflated, thinking I am worthless. No, I have some capacities. Let me use my capacities. Let me do the best that I can. And in due course, results will come. So again, Karma Yoga is a very, what I talked is a basic introduction to Karma Yoga. It's much more nuanced, but this will indicate that it's again a very empowering way of living by which we do all that is in our control and let go of what is not in our control. So Stephen Covey in his Seven Habits of Highly Successful People also talks about this idea of circle of control and circle of influence. So the Bhagavad-Gita doesn't use that language, but Karmanyogadhikaraste is talking essentially about the same concept that Stephen Covey popularized in his Seven Habits. And the Gita talks about it thousands of years earlier. So Karma Yoga is about focusing on what is in our control.